So 4 weeks ago, I said I'd see you in two, but... Wait.
What? How long has that been out of whack?
Yeah, better. Wow, that must have been irritating. Anyway, so 4 weeks ago I said I'd see you in two, but then conference season hit like a truck and I forgot that you actually have to travel to conferences and then you're not at home speaking to people face to face. I know it's weird, but I really hope to be back on a 2 week schedule now. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to look at the changes to pattern matching in its third preview, case refinement and null handling. I'll assume you already know how pattern matching in Switch works in the current preview, so I'm not going to go over that. If you don't, check out Inside Java Newscast number 8 or my Oracle Dev live talk, Pattern Matching in Java 17 and Beyond. With that out of the way, let's dive right in. JDK Enhancement Proposal 427 was recently published and it proposes two changes to pattern matching in Switch, how case refinement works and how null handling works. To make that clear, we're discussing nitty-gritty details here and they may very well change before this feature gets finalized. So this is not a how-to episode, this is background info so we better understand the deliberations behind this feature. And it's just good fun to peek behind the curtains. But we shouldn't miss the forest for the trees. Where's trees behind that curtain? The big picture is that Switch slowly gains expressiveness and becomes a more relevant programming construct in Java. And while it's an important place to use patterns, it won't be the only one. That means this feature includes larger considerations like squaring additions with our current understanding of Switch and making sure that the semantics of patterns in Switch align with their semantics elsewhere. As I said, we're just looking at some nitty-gritty details and we'll leave some open ends. Classic Switch compares a variable to specific values and picks the branch that matches. With patterns in Switch, the variable is matched against types, each essentially a big bag of all values that are legal for that type. For example, all integers between minus and plus, about to billion for integer, and all character strings for string. But we do not always want to treat all instances of one type the same. Maybe we distinguish positive and negative integers, or strings that do or don't contain a specific substring. These conditions can of course easily be expressed with an if. When the context of a switch that mean a type pattern, an arrow, and an if before finding the statements we're actually interested in. Instead of condition arrow statements, we get conditions part 1, arrow, conditions part 2, statements. This is where guarded patterns come in, or rather came in. JEP 427 proposes when clauses instead. Both allow adding Boolean conditions to a pattern to identify the desired case, say positive integers, on the left side and then put only statements after the arrow. When clauses, as proposed by JEP 427, differ from guarded patterns in two aspects, which construct owns the refinement and how the refinement is expressed. As the name suggests, guarded patterns were part of the pattern syntax, which was very powerful. For example, once nested patterns are introduced, it would have allowed us to add Boolean conditions inside a large pattern, not just at the end. Overall, this approach had some weird edge cases though that the JDK team wants to avoid, so now it's no longer the pattern that owns the refinement, but the case. I gotta say, I thought guarded patterns being part of the pattern syntax itself was pretty clever, and I'm not convinced of this change. The other aspect is the syntax of how to express a refinement. We're used to seeing ampersand as a strongly binding operator between equitable terms. That worked reasonably well for guarded patterns because they were actually part of the patterns, but less so if case owns the refinement. As Brian Getz wrote on the Ember mailing list, it's harder to imagine ampersand as part of the case and not as part of the pattern. So the current proposal is to use the new context-specific keyword when between the pattern and the refining Boolean conditions. My favorite topic to rant about, null. Once again, it sullies beauty with its dark presence, specifically by having us deal with it in pattern switches. Historically, switch simply throws a null pointer exception when the variable is null. But the more we switch over complex types, the more urgent becomes a better way to handle that case than a separate if before the switch. Since the first preview version of pattern matching in Switch, and unchanged by JEP 427, it is possible to add a case null for this special case and even combine it with the default. The question is, what happens without that case? In the second preview in JDK 18, the answer to that depends on the presence of an unconditional pattern. That is a pattern that matches all possible instances of the switched variable's type. Think of a switch or a variable of type shape, where the last case is case shape s. That always matches, it's unconditional on type shape. Unconditional patterns even match null, meaning in JDK 18 the variable s could be null, that would probably lead to a number of null pointer exceptions in its own right, and I wasn't a fan of silently sweeping null in with the other shapes. Fortunately, JEP427 proposes to change that. Unconditional patterns still match null, but switch won't let it get that far. If there is no case null, it throws an NPE without even looking at the patterns. Interestingly, this top-level behavior does not extend to nested patterns though. An unconditional nested pattern will still match null, which introduces a sharp edge during refactoring. This is inconsistent, but consistently not matching null also has weird effects, like not being able to write a single pattern that matches all instances of a record. A solution to this kerfuffle that I'll personally be pursuing is to flat out avoid null. Actually, I'm already doing that, but that's beside the point. Anyway, when null isn't legal, switches don't have to mention it, and while I would have found it nice if they threw exceptions on encountering it, it isn't really their job to do that. Speaking of jobs, are you listening to all this and thinking, I could do a better one? Show us and join the Java Platform Group. Oracle is looking for all kinds of roles, from language and tooling engineer to compiler developer, from JavaFX engineer to developer advocate. Wait, are they looking to replace me? Why? What did I do wrong?
And that's it for today's Inside Java Newscast. If you have any questions about the content we covered, leave it in the comments below. If you enjoyed this comment, leave it with a like or share it with your friends and colleagues. If you don't like this content, share it with your enemies. We'll see you again in 2 weeks, hopefully. Until then, so long!